At a security conference, Microsoft mentioned that 70% of all their vulnerabilities were about memory safety issues. That's a pretty big deal, and Rust seems to combat that issue and more. After hearing all the hype surrounding Rust, I had to go check it out for myself and see if it really is up to the standard that most people hold it to. Being the most loved language in 2022 for its 7th year in a row, I had pretty high expectations for it, and it's safe to say that the language matched, if not beat, my expectations. I want to quickly talk about the basic syntax first. For starters, to declare a variable, you use the let keyword, followed by the variable name and type. In this case, x is of type i32, or a 32-bit signed integer. Rust, like other low-level languages, has many integer types, both signed and unsigned. In most cases, i32 will fit what you need. For some context, i32 is the same as a Java int or a C++ long. Rust doesn't necessarily need type annotations for variables, as the Rust compiler has type inference. As a personal preference, I still try to use type annotations where I think there may be confusion. However, it's nice that they're not required in all situations. Rust does need type annotations for functions, as those help the compiler detect errors. By default, all variables in Rust are immutable, which means they can't be changed later. In order to make them mutable, you just insert the mut keyword before the variable name. This allows the value of them to be changed later, which can be useful in many situations. However, it gets a little bit more complex with ownership and the borrow checker, but I'll talk about that in a minute. Rust also has a feature that I find quite useful with the underscore keyword. An underscore is used as a placeholder, usually for a function return value or destructuring an argument. For example, if you have a function that squares a variable but also prints it out, you may not always need the return value. In this situation, you can simply use an underscore to collect its value. In general, Rust has a lot of nice syntactical features, such as tuple destructuring, macros, blocks, great iterators, and more. If you want to learn more about how to code with Rust and get better with the syntax, I've linked a couple of sources in the description. While Rust has great syntax, that isn't why it solves modern coding problems. That, in my opinion, is where its error handling and borrow checker shine. Error checking is an important part of code, and that's one of the many places where Rust shines. Rust errors are slightly different from most other languages. Try-catch doesn't exist in Rust, so there's no way to handle errors, which is by far the best way to code. Jokes aside, Rust has results, which are recoverable errors, and panic, which is an unrecoverable error. When a program panics, the code abruptly stops and provides the developer with feedback on what happened. You can also manually call panic with the panic macro. Rust's unrecoverable errors can be implemented with result. However, I want to talk about another enum called option because I think it's really useful in preventing errors. Many times, I'll be coding and I realize I need to return a function that either returns a null or a value. Writing code like this usually isn't the best coding practice, as the end user now has the chance to use a null variable without them knowing, which could compromise the safety of the code. For example, in this snippet, both dereferencing the null pointer and using that value could cause a seg fault. In Rust, you don't have to worry about this issue because of the option enum. Option is an enum with two variants, sum and none. Sum means an element of type T was found, and none means, well, nothing was found. In this code, we can use the getFromVec function to get an item from a vector, which just returns the item at a certain position. At a first glance, the code looks great, but I'm sure you guys can see the problem. If you were to give the function a position that is greater than the vector length, our code would panic. To mitigate this issue, we can check to see if the given position is less than the vector length. If it is, we return an option with the variant sum of our expected return value. In the case that the position is invalid, we can return none. As you can see, this fixes our problem for returning an item that is out of bounds of our vector, and it also addresses the issue I had earlier pertaining to returning null from a function. With an option, you can't access the data directly, but rather have to use the unwrap function. This handles the option implicitly, and will return the element in the sum, or it will panic as it receives a none. Using unwrap can be more risky unless you are absolutely sure that it will not return none. The user shouldn't be the one finding out about the error, so it would be safer to use another way to access the data. You can use match to handle both the inner element and the none. This way, our program won't panic and the user can use the application with no crashes. Rust also has the result enum, which describes possible errors instead of possible absences like option. Results have two variants, OK and error. OK means an element T was found, and error means that there was an error with element E. Results are important because they must be used. The compiler will issue you a warning if you ignore its value. This is just another small thing that makes sure the code is safer. In this snippet, we try to get some directions from a file. IO is a common place where errors could occur. If the directions.txt file doesn't exist, the code could have crashed. With results, we can find out if the file is valid, or get the error, and inform the user about it in our preferred method. In this case, we panic either way if the file is not found. The Rust borrow checker is an interesting beast and is a key part of how the language maintains memory safety. Each variable is considered the owner to its data, and the ownership can be transferred or borrowed. In the case of a vector, if you try to pass the vector to a function, you essentially transfer its ownership to the function, as vectors are not copied when passed by value. This makes them unusable after, as we don't know what happened to it in the function because we don't have control over how it was accessed. The vector could be considered unsafe after it was passed to the function. Now you may wonder how to modify and read variables while retaining ownership. That's where the magic of mutable and immutable references come in. A variable can be immutably borrowed multiple times, but only mutably borrowed once. And this part is important. You can't change a variable while there is an immutable borrow to it. This functionality is to prevent a data race from happening. An example in a single-threaded program is if you have two references to a vector v1, one of them immutable and the other mutable. If you were to take the mutable reference and push something onto the vector, Rust may have to reallocate the whole vector depending on the size of it. Doing so would change its memory address, which would invalidate the immutable variable. Vector reallocation doesn't happen every time. However, the strict borrow checker enables memory safety in the cases that it does happen. In order to abide by these rules, you have to be a bit careful when planning out variable ownership and how it will be borrowed. In a function, if you want to edit the data that you pass to it, you can use a mutable reference. However, if you just need to access the data, an immutable reference will work just fine. While Rust has a huge focus on safety, not everything can be achieved with these restrictions. Unsafe code gives you the ability to dereference a raw pointer, call an unsafe method or function, access mutable stack variables, implement an unsafe trait, or access fields of a union. Not all unsafe code is bad, and we can have unsafe code in safe functions via safe abstractions from unsafe code. For example, the split@mut function uses unsafe code. A naive approach would be to return two mutable slices. This won't work because there are two mutable references to the same variable, and you can't have that in Rust. Even though both slices are separate from each other, the borrow checker doesn't understand that. You can get this code to work by using raw pointers inside unsafe code. To make sure the program won't crash, there's a check to see if the middle index passed is less than the length of the array. This usage is an acceptable use of unsafe code, and successfully creates a safe abstraction from it. Rust has zero-cost abstractions, which basically add higher-level programming concepts with zero extra cost in the runtime. However, they may make for a slower compile time. Any operation that has zero-cost abstractions is as fast as doing the same code with its lower-level counterparts. For example, in this code, we calculate the sum of even numbers in an array. The first example uses iter and filter with the sum method, and the second example manually calculates the sum with a for loop. When I compiled and hashed the code, both binaries gave me the same hash, which means they compiled to the same machine code. One of the biggest things going for Rust are its error messages. I've mentioned them before, and they're the thing that initially drew my attention to Rust. Even while making this video, I noticed that error messages are generally quite helpful. I'm sure these error messages play a factor in why Rust is the most loved language, as they just make writing code so much easier. Rust is a great language. With my time using Rust, the language exceeded my expectations in many ways. The emphasis on memory safety is great and makes sure programs don't crash as much. Like any language, it isn't perfect. The borrow checker, while extremely useful, can be annoying to deal with sometimes. It sometimes feels like the time I spend debugging memory errors just transferred over to figuring out why the borrow checker is yelling at me. The Rust docs are also very helpful, and while it isn't specifically about the language, it's useful to have thorough documentation. The syntax is considerably modern, and the growing community only makes the language better. While I didn't talk about it in this video, Cargo makes it easy to manage packages, and depending on the complexity of the code, build the files as well. I don't think Rust will derail a language like C or C++ anytime soon, or even ever. However, it is a great language, and I think it's one that if you want to try something new and you have the time, you should give it a shot. Thanks for watching. I'll see you guys later.